away from me. If you shy away from me, you know, like, you would not, you change the idea.
Sonia Vera, a dedicated community organizer, a longtime representative of the Puerto Rican Day Parade Committee. In my eyes, she is a strong woman, a warrior, and an amazingly loving friend. I truly appreciate this opportunity. It's an honor to meet myself and my brothers from the Lost Five Foundation. We are truly thankful. I know this event wasn't an easy task. Sonia looked high and low for supporters and was met with much opposition. just like many of us who are out here pushing to spread the indigenous identity to our community. But through her dedicated work and her personal and her willpower, she did not stop there. And for that, we have this event today. I would like to also thank the Newark Library for allowing us to have this event here. It is a true pleasure, and we truly appreciate that you can continue to embrace and support cultural values, arts, and education for our city of Newark. So, without further ado, I would like to introduce our first presenter, Cacique Martin Casiva Opiel Veguilla. Martin Casiva Opiel Veguilla is the leader of El Concilio Taino Guatu Ma Cu Boriken, a community organization with a mission to increase public knowledge and awareness of the true Taino history and culture throughout the island of Puerto Rico and abroad. Through education and sharing the customs, language, craftwork, and conducting arrieros. Please, a round of applause for Cacique Martin.
Ok, pues muchas gracias por la invitación y por tener en consideración. Gracias. Yo le quiero decir verdad que a mí me había dicho que la relación de la defensa del pueblo está ahí, y yo mi cuerpo muy concreto de poder hablar de todo esto, ¿verdad? Porque muchas veces cuando aquí está y la tasa acá. Y noto que las personas que se identifican más con su cultura, con sus raíces, y eso me honra mucho porque no creo que ya hay el deseo de buscar, pero hay que hacer un poquito de fuerza que las personas se identifican más sobre la cultura. Pero otra cosa que sí le quiero decir es que esto está en el corazón la mente del pueblo puertorriqueño, y a mí, pues. Yo les quiero decir que mi abuela fue la que comenzó todo este sentimiento en mí. Que soy huérfano de padre, mi padre lo mataron, yo no lo conocí apenas cuando yo tenía 3 meses de nacido. Y mi abuela fue la que influyó mucho porque mi madre tuvo que venir para el estado para trabajar. Mi abuela siempre me decía, yo vengo de indios, vengo de todo el día. Su abuela viene de un pueblo indígena y el desarrollado era de ella. Y ella dice que venía de una india que se llamaba Huellara, que fue bautizada desde el nombre de Goya. Que buscamos ese nombre y aparece en el registro de los sitios de Carlos, en San Lorenzo. Eso quiere decir que sí hay este pueblo. Y siempre me mandaba a buscar. Una planta me decían, y decía, ¿esta planta es como un cabello? Yo lo que me faltaba conocer era la mujer de consuela, pero ya gracias a Dios la identifiqué. Antes de morir ella, me había mostrado para hacer la planta que era la que me gustaba. Después de la fractura, yo sin ella. Esto quiere decir que a través del tiempo, de los tiempos, los taínos seguían, a pesar de la imposición española, ellos seguían con sus tradiciones. Ellos traían muchas palabras y costumbres que se quedaron plasmadas en mi memoria, porque yo fui un nieto criado por una nieta de una abuela que era nuestra niña, que nació una vez a los 5 años ahí, en Ramadán de Señora. Yo siempre recuerdo también que ella me decía que había un cacique que se llamaba el cacique Magomio. Yo decía, pues un cacique con ese nombre. Que tenía un cuento de mi abuela. Entonces ella me contaba cosas que era como decir que un español vino desde Santo Domingo y dice que allá él conoció tres secretos. Y dice que esos tres secretos le fueron revelados por una india. Y uno era una mina de oro, otro era la cura de la tigre, por medio de una planta de pavo santo, de hecho, en Guatemala. Y otra era la fuente de la muerte. Creo que viene bastante, lo que pasa es que se lo digo en un momento. La cosa era que cuando llegamos, hemos conocido el proceso, él llegó a sitio donde se llama el cacique Macuña. Y me dijo, ya tengo a mí el cacique Macuño. Y el cacique donde llegó, cuando se León, a conocer la fuente de la vuelta fue Macuña. Macuña era el cacique que comprendía la parte de ahí bonito, que era yo, y ahí donde precisamente fue el bonito de Cubano, que es donde están los baños de Cubano, los baños de mar de Cubano. Pues mi abuela decía, yo le dije antes, tiene que ser los baños de mar de Cubano, que pretende por la mamá de mi bandera, que se encontraban en los baños de Cubano, y me un acuerdo de una cosa de memoria, y me dice, pero como para el mundo por ahí, en mar. Ya no están los talentos presentes porque lo vení trayendo de boca en boca a través de sus abuelos, hijos y nietos. Siempre nos decían en nuestra casa, y estoy seguro que en la casa de que ustedes tenían una abuela taína, una abuela mía, ustedes tenían un abuelo mía. No intento la casa de ustedes, porque no tenemos talento nada, alguien que quede ahí en Canarias, que es español, pero a mí me tengo que encontrar conmigo, porque esto era lo que me llenaba a mí. Yo vi que cuando mi abuela encendía el fogón, una de las cosas que hacía era que ella ponía las tres piedras, por la noche cubría un tronco con ceniza. Y cuando cubría con ceniza, yo siempre lo observaba, pero no sabía qué era lo que ella estaba haciendo. Ahora, por la mañana siguiente, ella se acababa de ceniza, y empezaba a hablar, ponía el fuego. Ese era el secreto de mantener el fuego para hacer la taína antiguamente, y me la traía. Ese secreto que para mí tenía mucho valor. Cosas que nosotros tenemos que recordar y saber que sí, nuestra cultura, nuestro proceso, estaban presentes en cada tradición de nuestros pueblos y todavía. Yo me propuse. Cuando fui a la Universidad de Puerto Rico, me gustaba mejor en los asuntos taínos. La arte práctica en los asuntos taínos. Todo lo que fuera taíno era lo que a mí me importaba. Ya que fue especial en la crónica, y si me interesaba cómo los invasores afectaron a Santo Domingo, que era cuando estaba allí, que ellos hicieron un masacre. Ellos inventaban todo tipo de tortura. Como si ellos vienen ahora. Pero esto es lo que la realidad de lo que está escrito en la crónica, lo que hicieron en nuestras tierras, lo que hicieron en Cuba. Estas cosas que están escritas en la que nos pueden llegar. Estas cosas tenemos que tenerlas presentes. ¿Sabes por qué? Porque nosotros, si olvidamos lo que sucedió en el pasado, estamos condenados a repetirlo. Por lo tanto, tenemos que recordar todos los días, y hay gente que dice a mí, tú no puedes estar diciendo ya tantas cosas. Bueno, no quiero decirla porque si no, Dios se va a repetir. Yo necesito educar a ese pueblo. Y la cosa es que es un concurso de educación del pueblo que todos los días se asumió cuando nos dan una escuela para poder pasar de nuestra escuela en Puerto Rico. Miren, fuimos a declarar la capital taína en la Guayanilla, que el alcalde nos da una escuela ahí, si interesa. Pero vamos a verla, cuando encontraron esa escuela, estaba destruida totalmente, vandalizada, y con una tienda antigua, para una escuela de Guayanilla, estaba bien deteriorada. Nosotros lo vimos, nosotros por todos los días en este mismo contexto, yo le agradecido, y le decía, ¿cómo usan ustedes esta cosa de Polilla? Le digo que nosotros no teníamos nada para enseñar para la cultura taína. O sea, nosotros tenemos que seguir llevando esto, como si fuera una cultura nueva, a todos. Nuestros países caribeños. Estoy seguro que los países del centro, como Santo Domingo y Cuba, todavía estos días siempre los ancestros. Estos días querían pedir a sus ancestros para ayudar a las tradiciones, porque yo las he leído en el internet, y yo también les respondo a mis páginas. Ellos vienen conservando, estos días vienen conservando estas tradiciones, porque por lo tanto, están ahí. Y muchas veces las personas dicen, ay, pero que tienen ellos de indio, porque se ven como si fueran más africanos, porque se ven este más blanco, tienen sí, porque ellos son producto de las plantaciones que hicieron la familia. Esas personas que ustedes ven ahí, que aunque no tengan el pelo como debía conocerla, los indios, esas personas son caídos. Y eso es caído, lo hacen de la cabeza. Porque en el Toa, dice la crónica muy claro, dice que iban los africanos y violaban a las niñas, esposas de los indios que buscaban en las tribus. Y a la que se resistía, cantaban. Y los españoles hacían lo mismo, que están explotando sexualmente a las indias y a las tribunías. Y eso es lo que nosotros tenemos que recordar siempre. El sistema no se puede recordar, eso hay que recordarlo. Porque si nosotros no recordamos estas cosas, se nos olvida y las vamos a recordar. Mi abuela siempre decía, mi mamá nunca me había dado mucho gusto de los taínos, así que ella estaba bien muerta, la cultura espiritual de taíno, indígena, ¿verdad? Pero ella me dijo una vez algo que a mí me chocó, le dijo que antiguamente los españoles ponían a la ciudad que se unían por los nombres, viene con una antena, le cortaban los textos. Eso lo dio mi mamá. Yo le dije, quiero preguntar a las clases de situaciones que corrían dentro de la familia y dice que todas estas cosas que suceden y que sucedían pues, son parte de nuestra historia y la traían nuestros abuelos en su remota memoria y la transmitieron a nosotros. Muchas personas que dicen que este señor porque tiene memoria, no es como que yo no voy a ganar. Ni siquiera los españoles odian, pasa que yo lo he contado sin iniciar. ¿Me entiendes? Yo no tengo odio de nada porque yo lo que hago es que recordar. Crónica. Somos taínos y aquí estamos. Y yo les digo una cosa. A mí se me ha hablado del ADN. Es una cosa que estoy. Y cuando me dieron, yo sabía precisamente esa semana para España. Yo le dije al profesor Martínez, pues yo tengo un DNA que está, es el resultado para hacerlo porque yo necesito llevarle ese resultado para España, para que yo sepa que estamos aquí. La semana 9, me acuerdo, que yo cuando le dio, empezar a sábado, cuando le dio aquí el resultado, cuando salió el resultado, pues, decía a los grupos y de la persona. Y yo cuando le dio ese resultado, yo me reía, pero miren, eran de comunidades tan grandes que yo no podía dar creyentes. Y me habían dicho, para que creen en la fe espiritual, que ese día, precisamente, vino el tiempo que iba a reformar la misa, que me iba a sentir que me había recompensado todo mi esfuerzo con mi trabajo. Mi trabajo para concentrar los dedos, y la manera de recibir fue esa, para mí es solo. Estamos presentes y aquí están todos cada uno de ustedes. Todas las personas que se encuentran en el Caribe, todos, yo los veo como si fueran ahí. Y le quiero contar la experiencia que yo tuve cuando fui a la fiesta de Santo Domingo, llegué hasta la Guatu Ma Cu Boriken, porque me llegaron hasta allí. Pues yo estaba por la montaña, el sitio. Que no estaba en la persona de allí, así lo digo cuando llegué. Cuando llegué allí, yo me concentré en los tambores que están tocando. Cuando de momento yo lo conozco, veo que vienen muchos taínos caminando hacia mí. Y yo me sorprendí, porque yo dije, Dios mío, esto es una visión. ¿Sabe qué era? Gente local, de sitio, que vienen caminando hombres, mujeres, niños, uniformados. De escuela, porque yo lo veía cuando eran sin roja. gente y el corazón de cada persona que encuentra en el camino. Por esa bendición, por una persona, como me llegó una muchacha que fue la mire, oye, la grande, así con cuerpo, pues, que no parece de Taina, y ella no había que decir a bailar con mi mierda. Cuando hice la prueba, salió en Taina. No lo tengo aquí ahora, la verdad. Esta muchacha, esa parte de que quién puede cambiar una cosa que siente en el corazón de la persona. Porque es que eso ya lo lleva. Usted tiene que explicar con Taina, usted está ahí. Usted no siente identificado con esta cultura, porque hay algo en su familia que trae él y nadie va a quitar eso. Aquí estamos. Usted, su cuerpo. Por lo tanto, tenemos que correr esta final de la calle. Nos gusta hablar de la plena, nos gusta toda la cultura africana, nos gusta también el flamenco, pero eso viene de afuera. Lo de vosotros no lo local. Lo que estamos haciendo en principio es lo que nosotros creemos y buscamos. Me siento bien orgulloso de esta lado. La espiritualidad nuestra nos ha dado algo. Y es que cuando nosotros le decimos a las personas que nos vestimos como indios, hay algunas personas que dicen, ustedes se visten de indios porque ustedes son como un show. Es un show. Es que nosotros vestimos como indios. ¿Sabes por qué? Para matar a los resistentes. Porque nadie lo había creído, nadie había cuidado de ellos. Ahora nos acordamos. Y ahí yo me comento, ¿sabes qué? No se creen que nosotros estamos, cuando hacemos la ceremonia de acá, con las palmitas estas que venimos aquí, nos ponemos. No, allá estamos los varones con la carta por favor. Tocamos el sitio activamente. Y eso no es nada, fíjate. Fuimos a Guayaquil la última vez donde declaramos la capital de que es un pueblo retirado. Cuando fuimos allí, hicimos una presentación aquí con la palita que acabamos. Cuando fuimos allí, todo el pueblo protestó porque decía, no, no estamos indios, no nos queremos que ustedes estén allá en el sitio. Y extrañó porque la verdad es que no quieren bien. Y ese pueblo lo mismo ha sido que nosotros queremos ustedes como pueblo. Y en ese sitio los niños de los indios. Y el pueblo cada día sé que hay pueblos que necesitan más seguimiento, pero nosotros trabajamos. Los necesito 75 días del año. Las 24 horas del día para traer la cultura nacional y el orgullo por todo esto. Aquí nosotros no hay lucro propio. Si así fuera, pues tuviéramos una mansión y tuviéramos un carro del año. Lamentablemente, yo tengo que depender de donde está aquí. Que lleguen a los niños, porque aquí no hay. Así que lo único que yo les digo es que ahí estamos para el 25 de junio con la sede de nuestro plante, que están todos invitados. Para que ustedes quieran hablar conmigo, yo estoy para que yo no voy a hablar. Y cuando ustedes quieran hablar una presentación que es maravillosa, pues ahí vamos a ver también lo mismo que yo tengo con cualquier mujer, hermana de la. Los taínos existimos, los taínos estamos aquí. Y vamos a seguir aquí y nada de nadie nos va a dejar. O sea, nos va a quitar esto que somos. Esto nos llena la vanidad, nos llena el alma, el espíritu, nos llena el cuerpo, porque esta es la cultura que nos quitaron, nos arrebataron hace muchos años, pero prevaleció nuestros viejos. Y nosotros somos los hijos, los nietos, de aquellos días que no podemos, ellos no podemos quemar, que pudieron huir. Aquí estamos.
Visita de Taino Indigenous, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible, the scholar, Aberis, is a member of the Taino Nation of the Andes, one of the leading scholars of American Indian policy and the contemporary Native experience, and a pioneer activist in Native American journalism and publishing. Dr. Barreiro retired in December 2016 as an assistant director for research and director of the Office Latino America at the National Museum of the American Indian, part of the Smithsonian Institution as well. Following presentations in Centennial Hall, Dr. Barreiro would be also signing books if we are able to tonight, no? All right. Well, let's see, God willing. Well, all right, give a round of applause for Jose.
I'm really happy to be here. They call me a teacher and professor, but I really learned from these guys a lot. They're really dedicated to picking up the pieces, turnover, puzzle that happened to us. Colonialism turns you over, start to pick you apart. And that's this journey that we're on now. At its base, at the moment that we're in, is about decolonizing. It's about indigenizing. And what does that mean, indigenizing? We talk a lot about identity. But indigenizing means that relationship to the land, the relationship to the base, the relationship to Mother Earth, appreciation for the elements, the sun, the moon, stars, the water, the air, the four directions we speak about. Four directions, we hear that from Native people a lot. Four directions, how to square ourselves. Four directions, just finding your way on the earth. But there's also the four cosmic directions, find your way on cosmic, find your way spiritually, find the depth of who we are. I'm from Cuba, luckily spilled of our three countries, primarily Jamaica, it also belongs in here, some of those other islands. But Cuba remains its Taino name, Cuba. Cuba means large, well-planted land. Taino name, Spanish tried to change the name of the Andina, and years later to Juana. Princesses, but he never took it. He always came back to Cuba. You have to wonder, why do people not appreciate, you know, the changing of that name? Why didn't they accept that? Same with my home area, on our way. They called it Puerto Príncipe, but that didn't last. They reverted back to our way. And so that depth, you know, that thread that comes out of the earth when we're born, that thread has a depth inside the earth. The Maya, with whom I do quite a bit of work, I love the Maya people. I've had the privilege of working with some of the strong Maya people that work with the calendar. And today is a cup. It's the 20-day cycle of the Mayan ceremonial calendar. Today is a cup. And cup means the net. It means the net that you throw off and catch fish. It means the net that you perform in. It means the net of your family. It means the fire of your family. Now that fire sometimes makes its own with its flashy eloquence, its brilliance. That's the family. I think that's really appropriate. Things don't happen without a reason. That today we're together. We're family. Taino is not a island. Taino is the sea. Taino is how we communicate with each other across the island. And if you see our people in Cuba, I'll show you that too much. We have something perhaps a little bit more than the other islands. We're a major island. Cuba is about the size of Virginia. A little bit smaller than New York State. It has strong mountain chains. People were able to hide for many generations. They took to the mountains, Marrones, Arenques, people who hid out from the Spanish over time, went to those mountains. They got lost. And even today, after 50 years of hiding, highly conscious socialist government in most every square inch of the country, there are still values where sometimes you find something that they didn't realize was still there. Really more values. So, a little bit here, this is on the Taino name for the islands. Pretty amazing that actually had survived. But Cuba, you know, Cuba is a very contested place. It's defied American imperialism, and it's not a country without problems. A lot of problems inside the country, but it is a sovereign country. It is a sovereign country, and it stood its ground. And whatever one can say about it, love them or hate them, that whole system, they stood their ground. And today, they are still there. The place I want to talk about a little bit is the far eastern tip of the country, the snout of the Cayman, the snout of the crocodile that Cuba is. And it's in that triangle that you have the most native communities, especially in the province of Montana, famous for the American base. And there in Montana there's a particular community of many more, 22. Strong native communities that come out of a particular kinship group that I'm going to tell you about. Because what we have is a little bit more in the sense, because it was a large place, because it was isolated, more identity in place as Indio, as relatives, kinship group was able to survive. But I like to see that because when I look at Puerto Rico, when I look at Iskaya, I see the same patterns, they're just more reduced. Puerto Rico has been that kind of a community did not quite survive. It survived in the people. And so when you're pulling together, when our team is pulling back together and other people, it's those threats that are still there and looking for our base. The Indian way, as a Seneca intellectual friend of mine, Eric Waltamboa, used to say, the Indian way is more than weeds and feathers. The Indian way is thinking tradition. There's a lot of thinking that went into our ways of life. There's a lot of thinking, generations and generations of elders, who each generation, the genius of that generation, picked up one more piece of knowledge about that land, about that tree life, about the urban life, about the animal life, about the way that the cosmos moves. And so that was added. Added again, and that was a piece that was seriously disrupted in the Spanish conquest. It was torn up. It was made into again a turnover piece of culture. And here's my cacique, Panchito Ramirez, a cacique who inherited his cacique though, because this is a historical community. This is a community that he inherited his cacique title in 1974. From the previous cacique, Ladislao, who was cacique from the turn of the century, around 1912 to 1974. That was the great uncle of Pachito. This is settlement day in Rancheria, in Montana. Some of the relatives getting together. Here's a little bit of the kind of conditions that people are, a lot of horseback, high up in the mountains. Curanderas doing the sobat, that's something that's done throughout the Caribbean. The use of the tobacco, the macuyo, they call the macuyo, they call the cigar, for invoking the four directions and the prayer of the macuyo. And the conuco is highly prized again. The conuco has come to be thought about as just a field. You plant a conuco of corn, but a conuco, Caruco implies an interplanting system. Machito calls it our store in the monte. This is, when you go, you pick a yuca, you plant a yuca. You pick a boniato, you plant a boniato. And that way, it's always turf. So the kick is sent out for the vegetables, for the meal, and you come back with it, but he knows how to plant one more. And so the Caruco, Cuba, that's a little bit on some of the evidence, the documentary trail of these communities up in the mountains. This is from 1946. After the revolution, there was a study commission to go up into those hills because Fidel Castro realized that a lot of his soldiers were Indians from up in those hills, long hair Wahinitos that he recruited that came to help the fight with his best guides, the best fighters that he had, he recognized them. And so he sent an anthropologist by the name of Manuel Rivero de la Calle to go up there and study them. Now, Rivero, this is a picture of him doing an interview with one of the residents up there. He was a physical anthropologist, so it was an anthropometric study. High cheekbones, the hair, the face, those kinds of qualities that are thought to be definitive of a human being. But in fact, he was able to prove that. And so in that sense, it was valuable because in Cuba, the same as all islands, the notion of extinction was settled. He said, that was it, there's just no more. You cannot speak of Indians. You cannot speak now. They accepted this, but it was descendants of Indians. So there was always still a separation from the past that was imposed. And of course, as you will see, in all of these headlines, there's always a sense of doom, extinction, the epitaph of the American Indians, the one before of Cuba. Well, the last Indians were a lot of generations now, and those generations are growing. So we're seeing, but then we've seen the agency of Panchito. The moment he became cacique, he started going out with his dance group, taking part in culture fairs around the Guantanamo or around the region. At first he wasn't accepted, but then he kept pushing, and he went from that kind of lack of recognition to a very strong recognition, and finally, and this is a book that I did first in 2001 with him, a testimony, an oral testimony of his life and his knowledge that I had to publish with an alternative press in Santiago, almost hidden, in 2001. And took a lot of guff from Cuban authorities for having published that book. But now, last year, it was published by Casa de las Americas. Casa de las Americas is the Cuban primary. So it began to change that consciousness. This is from a conference back when. This is the two Reinas, two of the elder women, very strong women. No, sorry, this Reina on the right, on the left is the other Reina's daughter, Idalis, who has surfaced in recent years as a very strong woman leader and likely to inherit the cacique title from Pachito. I asked him one time, all your kids? Four daughters and four boys as well. Who's gonna replace you? So it doesn't have to be one of my children, be nephew, preferably if it's a nephew, which is interesting because it's that matrilineal context that's still alive. But then he said, you know, this one he knows about 60% of what I know. This one he knows about 80% of what I know. Idalis, she knows 140% of what I know. So that was his way of saying it. She's a dreamer and a very strong community leader, people follow her. In 2003, as a result of the new repatriation laws that went into effect in the United States when the National Museum of the American Indian was created, which is essentially created to combat the idea of extinction, the idea of a living culture, that all this artifacts in museums, not just old bones and old archaeology, this is living culture. So the museum started out very strong. It was a big challenge to the Smithsonian and to museology in general about how to depict Indian people and how to depict people so that they could represent themselves. So there was a new methodology that got started there. It's a little bit shaky now. I have my criticisms on it, how it's been developing recently. But the methodology was you don't show any materials that the elders of that community can approve and go through with you, so you have a real living sense of the culture and a respect. So in 2003, in the midst of the Bush era, much going on, we were able to effect a repatriation of human remains, Taino human remains that were in the NMAI. And it's very interesting because the U.S. repatriation law, especially as administered by the National Museum of American Indian, requires that those remains go to a community of relatives. The Cubans and the government in Havana, very far away from this area, said, oh, wonderful, we'll get this bone, we'll be able to go over to the archaeologists, we'll study them. I said, no, this has to go to the community. Well, we don't have any Indians here. Well, yes, you do. When you read your own literature, look at all this stuff. Your own government did this. And of course, there was Pachito over there, you know, trying in the wilderness. And so we were able to, in 2003, with Pachito fishing and older days, backing him up and advising him that the repatriation took place. Here again, he's employing the Makuyo, the four directions of prayer. Some of the guys that we heard earlier, Wakamash was there for this, Siwana Khan, lost touch with, and other folks. Pachito made a pledge, or when the first man I met him, he said, I want you to promise me to help me do this. I want us to get better known. Queremos darnos a conocer. Estamos aquí, queremos darnos a conocer. Queremos conocer nuestras familias que se han ido bajando de la montaña a diferentes lugares. We want to have our people know each other, and we want to meet other Indians from other places in the Americas. And there has been a calumny, a lie told about our history, he said, especially this folks who are called the Rojas Ramirez, I'll tell you why in a minute. Because they say in the history books that we were traitors to the Cuban independence movement in the 1890s. And in fact, at the beginning of the war with Spain, 1895, the San Martín War, there had been a previous war, 25, 30 years earlier, 1868 to 1878. The Spanish figured out the Indians were pretty tough to fight. So when that war ended, they made every kind of overture, including granting new lands, so that the folks would pacify and the Indian people in particular would feel close to the Spanish government. So at the beginning of the war in 1895, the Indians joined, a group of Indians did join the Spanish, and they were all the only people ever that were able to ambush the great black general of Cuban independence, Antonio Maceo, who nobody could mess with. Maceo was 500 combats, and 500 combats, the only people who ever ambushed him were those Indians that were fighting against him, only for about 3 months at the beginning of the war. Then there was a huge, beautiful story of how that whole group of Indian people in 1895, not 300 years ago, in 1895, formed the Hatuey Regiment, the Regimiento Hatuey of infantry, that's written in the Indiana documentation from that war. Many, many of his ancestors, Panchitos, as he knew from moral history, fought really strongly in that war. And in fact, they have a valiant history of their participation in that war. But what we did for Pachito was help him move around. Here in our way, he went to visit. This is a group of about 70 of his people who are now on the northern coast of Camagüey. They migrated because of the special period in time of peace, what they call, in Cuba. Cuba became very dependent on the Soviet Union. Probably the biggest mistake they made was their agriculture. They turned it completely over to the Soviet. Huge state farms, huge machinery, high petroleum input. When the Soviets collapsed in 1989, 1990, the petroleum that was going into Cuba collapsed as well. From 1 month to the next, it dried up, completely dried up. So the agriculture, all those farms are still there. All that machinery is rusting 20 years later. Nothing else was ever done. But they were not able to do away with the small farmers, the mountain farmers, the farmers in the plains, the Guajimo. You guys have your Guajimo, Soto de Guajimo, both Taino word. Moshe, the term which meant a class of people under the Tainos and the Wahibu. Those are my people from Camagüey, from Wahibu from Camagüey. Came to this country as a young man, already knowing the stories of the Kawaii, the shapeshifters, and the Hiwis, the little people in Arta, the water ways. And so I ended up as a young refugee, 12 years old in Minnesota in 1960. That's a long story. But I ended up meeting a people in Minnesota, Ojibwe's, Shinabe. And I remember sitting around with the elders and hearing about the little people, the shapeshifters. I thought, we have all that. Where does that come from? It doesn't come from Spanish, it doesn't come from Africa either. Although the African population adapted as well. It was a real blending, as there was a tremendous amount of intermarriage between African and Taino. So it's obvious that it fuses into one people, but the foundation is the matrilinea. It's the matria. Not necessarily just patria. That sends us back to Spain, often. Matrilinea. And that was the Taino word. And that's utah, the herb. Utah, the cropping of the Taino system. Utah, many things to the young generation. As having an inner identity that we translated into Cubano, Puerto Riqueño, Dominican Republic, etc. No? Traducimos, traducimos a nuevas nacionalidades. But the foundation wasn't forgotten. And so, right from the beginning, all that teaching, all that ability to survive on these lands, all that the way of looking at it, the way of seeing the tremendous variety of trees of what each one is good for. And all that knowledge is up there. Our chief is incredible. We did a little experiment one day and just in La Tantelia, just one village. And we came up with 170 herbs in common usage. The women came up with about 70 of them. The young kids, when they were 12 years old, they had been invited to three groups, but they wanted to invite to have a competition. The young kids, under 12, knew about 45. And we asked them, how do the little guys know so much? And they said, well, who do you think was the big girl?
Folks, quiet down, folks. Please have respect for the presenters as they're here. They came from far away to present to all of you. Let's just have enough respect to sit in and listen to the folks out in the hallway. Please quiet down, or if you can, please come on in, take a seat to be a part of this great presentation today. Okay, let's continue on with the presentation. Cacique Martin has a 2-CD disc he's promoting here today. It's of the culture, of the language, and music of the Taino group. He's also starting a school that they actually been started already, he told me. But this is a part of it. The CD are going $20 per CD, and they'll be bringing it in shortly. Please.
Appreciation award to my dear friend throughout the whole year. She's been helping me get this program to where it is today. I want Milagro Santiago to please come up to the podium, please.
Thank you. noches.
Buenas noches.
Son sorpresas que uno no espera. Oye, me siento muy contenta esta noche y he visto tantas cosas hermosas. Nuestra herencia latina, nuestra gente hermosa, que muchas veces nosotros no entendemos, pero hoy hemos aprendido muchísimas cosas sobre nuestros taínos, el baile, ha sido muy hermoso. Quiero decir que cuando yo puedo hacer algo para mi gente, lo hago con amor, por eso con amor recibo este reconocimiento que yo no esperaba. Ustedes, para yo los veo como un árbol, el árbol de la vida, llenito de luces, porque veo su rostro, su sonrisa. Es hermosa nuestra gente. Debemos de querernos, respetarnos, de amarnos siempre. Darnos la mano. Cuando vemos que alguien está caído, levantémoslo, porque mañana no sabemos si es uno de nosotros los que nos vamos a caer. El amor que siga siempre en nuestro corazón y que lo compartamos para siempre. Gracias.
She's helping with the judges. She's my confidant. And I would like to give her this recognition.
Appreciate you.
Change her mind, but you know, she knows that I love her and that I
only wish her the best. And the parade is giving you this appreciation because you know that we love you.
That's right.
Jorge Baracutei Estevez, a Taino from the Dominican Republic, has worked at the National Museum of the American Indian, part of the Smithsonian Institution, for over 22 years. Currently, as a participant coordinator of public programs, he has done extensive research on the indigenous inhabitants of the Caribbean with a social focus on the Dominican Republic. He is a frequent contributor to the Smithsonian Magazine and has written essays for the Encyclopedia of Caribbean Religions.
Wow.
Everybody, give a round of applause for Cacique.
Okay, so a little bit about the Taino people. This is what we know according to archaeological records, and is that about 7,000 years ago, people from the Yucatan started island hopping. They actually went from the Yucatan into Cuba, and they made it to maybe as far as Puerto Rico. And then about 4,000 years ago, Arawakan-speaking people started arriving from Venezuela and Guyana. Okay, what happened? Sorry. So, just to understand who the Taino people were, the Taino people were a mixture of a lot of different people that came across 7,000 years to the island. So I put this together. This little, it's a very simplified version of what actually occurred. But we know for a fact that the artwork that defines what is Taino is Chicoide and Mexicoid style. The Mexicoid style was developed in the Dominican Republic, but it went into Cuba, Cuba and Jamaica, where it became the dominant style. And then in Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, it's the Chican style. So the what we call Taino culture itself actually was developed between Puerto Rico and the Mayaguez region and the Chican region of the Dominican Republic. So, as you all know, on October 12, 1492, we were invaded by the Spanish. I'd like to say that on October 12, 1492, that's the year that we discovered Columbus. Why? Because we were home and Columbus was actually very lost. The documents, the chronicles from that time, you see that the Spanish, you know, they had a lot of expectations as to what they were going to find in the Caribbean, one of them being gold. There was really very little gold in the Caribbean. So the next commodity was Indian slavery. Just like Martin mentioned a little while ago, you know, when they paint the version of history that you see in, if you read in school, especially when you're young, it's a very simplified version, and it's very cleaned up. But these woodcuts that come from that era tell you, show you exactly the atrocities that were being committed. The one here on the left, you see all the way on the left, that was from Jamaica, where the Spanish are hunting down Taino people using mastiff dogs. The one right in the center, that's from Cuba, and it's showing Taino people being cut up and actually being fed to the dogs as well to keep the dogs alive. And that's what the other woodcut says as well. And this is, like Martin said, these are things that we need to keep in mind, that these things actually happen and we can't forget these. So, a little later, after 1492, you know, there was a slavery which was called encomienda. There was a lot of Taino uprisings all across the Caribbean. The last known one was from the Dominican Republic, which was Enriquillo's war. He fought a war that lasted 15 years, and afterwards the Taino people were supposed to be free, but in somewhere or another, the Taino were still being enslaved. And then nobody actually knows for sure exactly, no two historians can agree, but we became somehow extinct. So if you want to read more about what actually transpired, you should read a lot of the quotes by Columbus. King Ferdinand's letter to the Taino is also a very interesting read, as it is, you read it, also the notes by Montesino and Bartolomé de las Casas. So Jose spoke to me about seven markers of indigeneity that are present in a population, and perhaps I'm not really explaining that right, but when Jose first mentioned this to me, I kind of understood what he was saying, because I've been doing this for a while. So the markers are like this. For example, this is the way I put them together. There's oral tradition, agricultural practices, material culture, customs, spirituality, language, genetics is one that I added to it, and identity. So oral tradition. All those pictures that you see here, they're mostly from the Dominican Republic, and these are different traditions that are still very strongly surviving in the Dominican Republic. For example, this is my mom and my grandmother, and we come from the town of Haipon. And my mother told us since we were very young that you know, we knew that we came from Indian people. My grandmother was very adamant about this. The picture that you see all the way to the right, that is our village back in 1962. One of the stories that my mother always drilled into us was the story of a Sigwapa, which is this creature that you see over here. A Sigwapa is a story of a creature that has very long hair and its feet are inverted. Sometimes they're said to be females, sometimes they're said to be males. So when I first heard the story, this was our cuco, by the way, in our house, this was our cuco. You know, everybody knows the cuco, right? But this was our cuco. So as I got older, I became curious and I started searching out what exactly is a Sigwapa, where does the story come from? Because somehow the story has become Africanized in the Dominican Republic. They try to give it an African origin. What I found is that all across the Circum-Caribbean region, all the Indians from Venezuela, Brazil, they have the same exact creature. They call it Urupia, Caipora, Siguanama, and Bush Taitai. And the one that you see over to the right is the Guije, which is from Cuba. And the Guije, the very same story, is also found in Guyana. It's called Olehiwe in Guyana. Another story that we have in the Dominican Republic is the Galipote. Galipote is a shapeshifter. This is a person that can actually turn into, shift into an animal or a fruit. In South America, it's called Galipoti. It's the same exact story. So basically what I do is that I gather all these stories and all these customs from the campo, and then I look at our relatives. Like, oh, in South America, you have the Arawakan people, and these are our relatives. This is where our ancestors came from. And then I try to look for connections that are found in the campo today with what's found in South America and also in the Chronicles. And one of the things that I find is also what's called the Indian spirits don't eat salt. In Guyana, they say that there are certain spirits that don't eat salt. In the Dominican Republic, we are told that Indian spirits don't eat salt as well. And perhaps that's a, you know, that connection is not that well, but that actually leads into something else that's a little more deep, but I can't get into that right now. El Indio del Chaco. This being that you see over here is called Pierre Babilan. He is a semi that supposedly lived in the Maguana region of the Dominican Republic. The story says that he walks on the ground like a dog on four legs. And if you see, he's really not a dog, because the fact is that he has no features like a dog. Well, in the Dominican Republic, that story is still believed, even to this day, by the campesinos. We call him El Indio del Chaco. It's very basically the same story. It's supposed to be this being that lives inside caves. The campesinos, they see him when he comes out of the cave walking on his four legs, and usually he'll jump into the river. And so that's one of the stories, like I said, that have survived. Another thing is tying water to stop the rains. This is also a story that I find amongst the Wapishana people, like I just confirmed the other day, and also amongst the Lakono people in South America. And so these are agricultural practices. Cassave. Everyone here from the Dominican Republic knows what cassave is, and I'm sure that the Boricuas know what it is too. Well, the cassave is made from the poison yuca, and that's the whole process there. The Dominican Republic is really, it's actually like obsessed with cassava making, because when you go deep into the campos, this is part of the staple of the people. And it's, what you see down here, this is actually a yuca. That's actually a yuca. It's a madre de la yuca. Okay, another custom that we have is making anduyo. Anduyo is the process of taking the tobacco and tying it up like you see up here, and then they bury it underground to make it ferment. This is the same type of tobacco in South America. And then these are some Taino foods that we have today. Like, for example, what's called boyo, which is made from the poison of the yuca. We call it boyo. We also make the mabi, the ayaca, chacá, ajiaco, chichueca, arepa, mamajuana, and chenchen. And then as for material culture, we have these baskets that we still make all across the Caribbean. And this particular pattern that you see here, that's found in are identical to the ones that they have in South America as well. And over here you have pottery making. One on the left is in Puerto Rico, one on the right is in the Dominican Republic. And also the boyero. The one on the top is from Cuba. The one on the bottom is from Jamaica. That one is from the Dominican Republic, the one that just popped up. And the one on the right is from Puerto Rico from 1940. Over here you have canoe making. Canoes are still made in the Dominican Republic today. This top picture over here is from 1916. As you can see, the canoe is still very much part of our culture. Over here, this is from 1936. This is from 1936, and that's from 2009, when the Coast Guard in Puerto Rico found some Dominicans who were trying to vacation illegally in Puerto Rico. Okay, so these are some Taino customs. In our music, in the music that's found in the Caribbean, you know, a lot of musicologists like to say that the Taínos have absolutely no influence in our music, and that's not true. The Jacana is a summer solstice song and dance that's performed once a year in the Dominican Republic. Macopa is another. The Haitian music that's called Lara also has indigenous roots. The Yagumo that you saw Martin playing a little while ago in his group, that also is part of the Lara tradition. Mahuita. Mahuita is cupping your hands like this. Exactly, that's Mahuita. And then you also have what's called Neo-Taino music. Now this one here is the Calayan. That's actually a moon dance that's still performed in the Dominican Republic to this day. And it's performed before planting any crops that have to be planted when the moon is full. Then you have also El Baile de la Cuyaya and El Baile de la Yuca. And this is one yuca dance. What happens is that when the people, the parents are making cassave, the children, they play this game where a little boy will stand on top of a stick, the poles, and then they move them back and forth and side to side, and the kids compete to see who could last the longest. But there's actually three yuca dances. There's this one, there's also one when they plant the yuca, and there's also one when they harvest the yuca. Another tradition is, of course, making bateras. This is a picture on the left of a Spanish person coming from Batea in the Caribbean. And the one on the right is a batea from today. The man over here, you see, he's fishing with a nasa. And a nasa is a cage, a fish trap. And when he does this, he swims from one side of the river to the other. And when he gets to the other side, the basket will be full of fish. And that's also a documented Taino tradition. On the left, that's a nasa, and over here, this one from the one on the right is from Cuba, that is also a nasa. Like I said, these traditions are also still part of our tradition. And when it comes to Taino spirituality, this gets really, really deep. In the Dominican Republic, we have a tradition that's called Taimani. To really understand Taimani, which is also called Agua Dulce, you have to go to this part of the Dominican Republic. This is in the San Juan de la Maguana area, but it's the most remote places. And what happens is that the people there, they believe that all the caciques are still prayed to, more or less. And they believe in certain elements that are water and stone. For example, the supreme being in Taimani is called Guamau. And when you look at the names that were recorded by the Spanish, by the Las Casas, Alonso de Ulloa, and Peter the Martyr, you see that Guamau appears, you see that Yogahubaba, Mauro Coti, Icaona, Maura, Guamau Mokon, but all of them have that Guamau in there. But this is the supreme being in the Agua Dulce tradition. So, in Agua Dulce, stones, cassava, water, stones, and tobacco are the central focus. The stone that you see on the top is La Piedra de Nagaona, where Nagaona was said to sit and recite the rayitos. And people come from all over the island to actually pay homage to her and also to leave offerings. And the caves that you see on the right-hand side on the bottom, that's where you find religions like the Vendión de Visión or Rigoristas, where they praise their altars. They have whatever is Spanish and is Christian, and the African on one side, and then have the Indian on another part of the cave. And over here, this is on linguistics, and these are just a bunch of names that I put down. But I'm actually working on a dictionary right now, and there are over, so far I have 2,800 names that I have documented, you know, from different dictionaries. But you gotta imagine that for a people that supposedly disappeared, you know, 500 years ago, we left a really deep impact on the Caribbean language, on the Caribbean Spanish. And then a little bit here on genetics. As you, most of you know already, that DNA studies have been done all across the Caribbean. So DNA, this is like DNA for drumming. DNA is something that's really hard to understand. I really don't understand it myself. But I come across it a lot, so I try to understand it. Mitochondrial DNA is the DNA that is passed down from a mother to her children, but only the female could pass it down. So this is the DNA that's actually found in the cell, in the nucleus of the cell. So in Aruba, they found that 82% of the people in Aruba have mitochondrial DNA that's indigenous. In Puerto Rico, it's 61%. In the Dominican Republic, it's between 18 to 33%. In Cuba, it's about 33%. Then you have Y chromosome DNA. The Y chromosome DNA, so far, according to the people who have done this kind of work, Y chromosome is the DNA that's passed down from the male to his male children, but the women can't transmit it. In the Dominican Republic, it's about 2% so far. And then AT DNA, which is autosomal DNA, that's the DNA that is responsible for your features, like, you know, that makes up your color of your hair, the shape of your face. So in Puerto Rico, the average is from 10 to 12. The Dominican Republic is from 8 to 10%. And Cuba, I really don't have numbers for that. But there are individuals that score even higher. Again, if the Taino people went extinct 500 years ago, none of this should be possible. And those two names that I have down there is Kajima Hamakuchi, is one group that did a study in the Dominican Republic, and Juan Martinez Cruzado from Puerto Rico. And in the Dominican Republic, where you find most of the Taino survival is in what I like to call the triangles, because these are the regions across these mountains that when you penetrate deep into the mountains, into the countryside, that's where you see it strongest. But the fact is that Taino culture has permeated throughout the Caribbean, throughout the island. Everywhere that you go, you always find at least one marker of DNA. And last year, I had the honor of working with Professor Haynes Schroeder, and they started doing a new kind of DNA work, which is ancient DNA testing. And basically what they were doing was that they were looking at the bones, Taino bones, and comparing them to the people, the modern people today. And I actually helped them in looking at some bones from the Dominican Republic. And what they found was that, as you see, you read the bottom, is that we find that the Native American ancestry present in Miami's Latino population of the region today is closely related to the ancient Taino, demonstrating that the indigenous ancestors survived until the present day. And the reason why that's important is because historians, even though the DNA already said, yes, the Taino people did survive, but the historians twist that and tell you that it's not enough, that whatever's there is not enough, and whatever's there is actually not from there, that it came from outside of the island as slaves or by recent migration. But this study tells you that what is there is ancient, and it's ours and it's us. So we are directly related to the Taino. That myth has been totally obliterated now with this study. So I'm very excited about that. And as far as identity is concerned, you know, we have a right to our own identity. You know, perhaps, you know, a lot of people within our population are not moved by Taino, you know. They might not like feathers, they might not like the way we wear our nagara, but we have the right to be whatever we want, you know. And I think it's interesting that, you know, that the same people, for the, you know, almost like the same, the people that took away, you know, our land and things like that, happened, the atrocities, that then their descendants today, which I call the allegists, are the ones who deny us, you know, the right to be who we are, you know. So as far as Taino identity is concerned, this is my grandmother's passport from 1961, the year that I was born in. And in her passport, she's listed as color indio. And that's a little tricky because what happens is in the Dominican Republic, they use that term politically. In some instances, it means exactly what it says, it's indio. But in other instances, it's actually used to deny negritude. You know, so basically in the Dominican Republic, there are no black people. They're just dark-skinned Indians, you know. So that can be problematic. But when you speak to people that are not, you know, part of the elite, that are not the educated, you know, the campesinos, for them, Indio means exactly that, it means Indio. So for my grandmother, when she was showing her passport, she would say, you see, I know that I'm Indian, but look at my passport, because To her, the fact that the Indio was spelled with a Y and not with an I, to her, was actually an indicator. But my grandmother told us that her grandmother was, in fact, full Indian on her father's side. And according to one of the DNA testing companies, which now, one of them is called 23andMe, they basically recently started doing this new test, this new thing where they tell you exactly when your last pure-blooded Indian ancestors lived. And they told me that, by the way, my grandmother was born in 1898. She died at 104 years old. And she said that her grandmother, who was born in about 1809, 1810, that she said that this is that she was one that was full-blooded Indian. And according to what 23andMe people are telling me now, that my last full-blooded Native relative was in 1820. So again, you know, for an extinct people, we're doing pretty good. So over here, Native iconographies you find all over Puerto Rican, Dominican, or Cuban communities. For example, this is a store up in Washington Heights, where you see Taino petroglyphs all over the place. Over here, this is Minnesota or Marta, Marta Puey, Cerveza Puey, etc., etc. Over here, you have Conuco de la Comunidad, or Conuco is also a Taino word. And this is one of the ways that we subconsciously still manage our identity. It's part of who we are. And of course, oh wow, I put that over here. So yeah, that's over there. We'll talk about that later. Anyway, so. So what I understand about the modern Taino movement is that, from my perspective, I remember that back in the late 80s, you know, Puerto Ricans started getting together and questioning, you know, saying, wait a minute, you know, we also have Indian ancestry. Why aren't people doing anything about this? Like, why aren't people reflecting it? And so they started getting together, we started going to powwows. And it was interesting because once we were going to powwows, the Indian people here would look at us and say, hey, you guys have been on dancing with us. So that kind of drove people to search out and research and do that. At one time, the Puerto Ricans in particular, because Puerto Ricans are the ones that have the strongest Taino identity as far as I can see. But we would dress like North American Indians. And that's actually a Puerto Rican. Puerto Rican lady, and you can see she looks very indigenous. The one right in the middle, that's my son when he was 10 years old. Later on, we started adopting regalia that was more akin to what our ancestors wore. I'm not going as far as what Martin said about the whole butt out and everything, but I understand the feeling, and that's another person. And then over here, this slide has to do with people's features. The ones right in the middle, those are from Cuba. You can see very dramatic Taino faces. The one on the left, the one in the middle is from the Dominican Republic, and then the ones on the right from Puerto Rico. And then over here, these are just Dominicans with Native ancestry. The ones on the top are all Native identified. The ones on the bottom are not, but you can see that they have Indian ancestry as well. And that's Higuayagua with some Wapishana Indians from Guyana dancing. That was from last week. And that's me, Paniquia. He was more vocal at that moment, but it got better. And we the Taino are still here. Thank you.
All right, everybody.